regardless of who we are or what our circumstances in life may be, at one time or other we think about what it's like beyond the door of death. We realize the fact that one day we must die, and thoughtful people are concerned about what their situation will be and what the Bible reveals regarding it. I'm going to speak then for a few minutes tonight about what's beyond the door of death. This is a subject that intrigues the young. The middle-aged ponder it in all seriousness, and the old daily wonder about that journey which they surely soon must take. Yet it's a matter about which we can learn nothing, save from the sacred writings. It is a fact that a child in 5 minutes may learn more regarding man's origin, his mission, and his destiny than the wisest of the ages have been able to learn in thousands of years outside its sacred pages. And while there are many questions that may be raised regarding what's beyond death, at the same time, there is much revealed. And while some of these matters must await the day of realization, it is nevertheless true that by a careful collation of Scripture, by drawing proper deductions therefrom, that we may learn much about what awaits us in this transition. By way of introduction to the theme, it's important for us, first of all, to raise this question. What is man? Until we know what we are, we're not in position to consider what happens when we die. And so, preliminary to any study that involves dying, there must be some consideration of what we are. And so we raise the question, what is man? That's a Bible question. We read in the 8th Psalm, and again in the 2nd chapter of Hebrews, what is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visitest him? But not only do the Scriptures raise the question, they answer it. For in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, we're told that God formed man from the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7, it is said that in death the body shall return to the earth as it was. Now, if this were all, if the Bible said no more than this, we might with reason conclude, along with the materialists, that man is indeed wholly mortal, that all there is of him is matter, that out of the dust was he made, and back to the dust does he return in death. But I'm glad to tell you that that's not all that the book has to say regarding us. For in Job chapter 32, verse 8, we read, there is a spirit in man. In Daniel chapter 7, verse 15, Daniel was grieved in my spirit in the midst of my body. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 1, God formeth the spirit of man within him. So these passages teach us that man is a composite being. He is composed of a body made from the dust. He has infused in him a spirit received directly from God. Here, incidentally, is refutation of that denominational doctrine of total depravity. As you know, the creeds, most of them, and most denominational churches teach that man is born in sin and that he receives hereditarily the guilt of his parents, that there is transmitted from parent to child some hereditary taint. They call this original sin. Some of them refer to it as the Adamic nature. Of course, it's positively false, for even if it could be shown, which it can't, that there is something transmitted from parent to child of a moral taint, it still wouldn't follow that our spirits are depraved, because we don't receive our spirits from our parents. We receive our bodies from our parents, but our spirits are infused in us directly from God. Paul, in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 8 and 9, contrasts the father of the flesh and the father of the spirit in these words. He said, we have fathers after the flesh, to whom we give reverence. Shall we not rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? Since God, then, is the Father of our spirit, and since like begets like, It follows then that when we receive the Spirit, it is as pure as the source from which it springs, and becomes guilty of sin only after personal transgression. For in 1 John chapter 3, verse 4, we read, sin is the transgression of the law. We noted moments ago that man is a composite being, that he's composed of a body made from the dust, that he has infused in him a spirit. Put the two together, and that's life. Separate them, and that's death. That, incidentally, is the best brief definition that I can formulate of life and death anyway. Notwithstanding the fact that we all possess life, though we see its manifestations around us regularly, it's not easy to define it. Suppose I should ask you, what is life? You have it, and you see it ever about you. What would you say? Perhaps you'd say it's a mode of existence. But I would immediately ask, but what's the mode of existence? And so the same problem would face us. About the best brief definition that I can formulate of life is, it is that state or condition obtaining while the spirit and the body are together. The best brief definition that I can give of death is that it's the state that exists after the spirit has left the body. For in James chapter 2, verse 26, we read that the body without the spirit is dead. It is not our purpose, nor is it necessary tonight, to spend time discussing the destination of the body. All too often, does it become our sad duty to follow the silent procession to the city of the dead, and there erect the sacred mound to need any evidence of the destination of the body. Out of the dust was it made, to the dust is it returned in death. What does concern us tonight is this. Where does the Spirit go? May I, for a few moments, discuss where it does not go? In the first place, it doesn't go into the grave. That's very evident from what we've just said. We're saying that death is the separation of body and spirit. It follows then that when the body is placed in the tomb, the spirit is not there. This, it strikes me, is a source of great comfort. That when it becomes our sad duty to give up to the tomb the body of a loved one, that we may take comfort in the realization that this is not the real person, but merely the house in which that person lived. As a matter of fact, that's the biblical concept of the body anyway. Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1 said, we know that if the earthly house of this tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building, a house from God, not made with hands, eternal and in the heavens. Notice that the apostle alludes to this body as a tabernacle. This translates the Greek word skene, the ordinary Greek word for tent, T-E-N-T. As you know, a tent is a very temporary dwelling place. In the Apostle Paul's inspired concept, this body is a mere tent in which for a brief time we live here on earth and out of which we move our death. And so, first, the Spirit does not go into the grave. Secondly, it doesn't go into purgatory. There is a Romish superstition born amid the darkness of past ages that individuals guilty of certain types of sin pass into a purgatorial realm where they expiate their sins by suffering for a time and then are released to go on to heaven. Let me simply say that there is not one scintilla of evidence in the Scriptures supporting that view. On the contrary, the Bible plainly refutes it. And so, for the moment at least, we dismiss it as unworthy of further consideration, this connection. In the third place, the Spirit does not go directly to heaven at death, regardless of how righteous, nor directly to hell, regardless of how wicked. And I say that, some funeral speakers to the contrary notwithstanding. On such occasions, such sentiments as these are sometimes heard. Now this individual has gone on into the eternal realms. Now enjoys one of those mansions which our Savior went to prepare. When I hear sentiments of that nature expressed, I reach one of two conclusions. Either the speaker is uninformed, or else he's disregarding what the Scriptures teach. I shall show you by the clearest reasoning and by the most irrefutable evidence that such is not so.
When our Lord was crucified, on either side was a malefactor, a robber on the right and on the left. At first, both of them railed on him. And one of them said to him, "If thou be the Christ, save thyself and us." The other one, becoming penitent, rebuked the railing robber and said, "Dost not thou fear God, seeing that we're in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing amiss." Then in penitence he turned to the Savior with this plea, "Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom." Our Lord answered, account of which is found in Luke 23:43, "Verily I say unto you, today shalt thou be with me in paradise." Thus that very day, our Lord and the penitent robber journeyed to paradise. But they didn't go to heaven, because 3 days later, account of which is found in John chapter 20, verse 17, when one of the godly women, unable to believe her eyes, seeing the risen Lord, thinking that she is seeing a ghost or having a hallucination, was about to run forward and touch him to see if he were really there. The Lord said, "Touch me not. It's not necessary to touch me to see if I'm here. I'm really here. I have not yet ascended to my Father." What? "I have not yet ascended to my Father." 3 days before, he went to paradise, but he hadn't ascended to his Father. But his Father was in heaven, but he hadn't ascended to his Father. Therefore, he hadn't been to heaven. But he had been to paradise, but he hadn't been to heaven. Therefore, paradise in that passage is not heaven. What is there anything in the sacred writings suggestive of what it is? There is indeed. In the great speech that Peter made on Pentecost, an account of which is found in Acts 2, he had occasion to quote a prophecy of David. He said, "David is both dead and buried, and his sepulchre is with us to this day. And he, being a prophet, knowing that God had sworn with an oath that of the fruit of his loins according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne. He, seeing this before, spoke of the resurrection of Christ." Now note, Peter said that David, in this prophecy, was referring to the resurrection of Christ. Well, what did he say about it? "Thou wilt not leave my soul unto Hades, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption." There are two things pertinent to our present purpose suggested in that passage. One, the Lord's body would not remain in the tomb till it decayed. His spirit, our soul, would not remain in Hades. But if it were not to remain in Hades, it had been in Hades. But it had been in paradise. Therefore, paradise was in Hades. But it hadn't been to heaven. Therefore, paradise in Hades is not heaven. Well, is there anything in the book suggestive of the nature or characteristics of Hades? There is indeed. Incidentally, the word Hades simply means the unseen realm. And when applied to the state of the dead, it means the unseen realm where the dead go. And is there then any description of it in the Scriptures? There is. And I introduce it without hesitation and certainly without apology. Sometimes when the case of the rich man and Lazarus is mentioned, account of which is found in Luke 16, there are those who smile and say, "But that's just a parable." I've never been able to appreciate the force of that objection. Mention the case of the rich man and Lazarus and somebody say, "But that's only a parable." I know not what one means by imposing such. The force of the objection is this. Now, after all, that's only a parable. Therefore, you can't rely upon it. That must be the force of their objection. In the first place, I'm not so sure that it is a parable. I know that some men thus classify, but men do nearly everything with a book. That influences me not one particle, unless there's some reason for it. Secondly, it doesn't begin like the parables. The parables usually begin by saying, "He spake a parable unto them saying." This says, there was a certain rich man. Was there? In the second place, it's not a characteristic of parables to mention people by name. A good definition of a parable is it's an illustration designed to make clear some obscure truth. It literally means to place something with which you are familiar, but the side of something with which you're not familiar, and point out the likenesses or the similarities. Well, now, waiving that just for the moment, grant that it is a parable. It either is or isn't. If it is a parable, it teaches that which could be. If it's not a parable, it teaches that which is.
either case, it teaches the truth. Now let's see what it is it teaches. There was a certain rich man clothed in purple and fine linen who fared sumptuously every day. There was a beggar named Lazarus laid at his gate full of sores, desiring to be fed with the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table, moreover the dogs came and licked his sores. It came to pass that Lazarus died, was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died, lifting up his eyes in torment in Hades, and seeing Lazarus afar from Abraham's bosom, said, Father Abraham, send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that in your lifetime you had your good things and Lazarus's evil things, and now he's comforted and thou art tormented. And besides this, there is a great gulf fixed between us and you, so that those who are here can't go there and those who are there can't come here. This then is the picture of the disembodied saint. Let's stop at that point and summarize briefly to see what we've noted. Number one, man is a composite being. He's made up of spirit and body. In death, there's the separation of these elements. The body goes into the tomb. The spirit wings its way to Hades. If it's a righteous spirit, it goes into paradise, or Abraham's bosom. If a wicked spirit, into a place of torment. Now let's take a look at some of the things stated in this narrative. First place, it said that Lazarus was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The expression Abraham's bosom is a figurative one, but its meaning would be immediately apparent to the Jews. It's based upon a practice that till this day obtains in Oriental lands of people eating at low tables, no higher, perhaps, than the second step up to the platform. Usually they have rugs near their table. They recline on those rugs at the table. The host, just at the head of the table. The guest of honor right next to him, hence said to be in his bosom. Since Abraham was the father of the Israelite race, to be said to be in Abraham's bosom was figuratively to be assigned a place of high blessing, so every Jew would understand it. Somebody might say, well, maybe this is a picture of the eternal state. How do you know? Because they were already, at least Lazarus, already in heaven, and the rich man already in the lake of fire. Many reasons. One is, this is a picture of disembodied spirits. Bear in mind that it's expressly stated that the rich man was buried. We may assume Lazarus was. And so this is a picture of people out of their bodies. And people will not go to heaven or hell until after the resurrection, after they re-enter their bodies. In fact, this occurred before the judgment. How do we know? You remember that finally the rich man recognized his own doom, but appealed in behalf of his brothers. He had brothers at home. He besought Abraham to send Lazarus to warn them not to come to that place of torment. But Abraham said, they've got Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. What? Why didn't he say, let them obey the gospel? Why didn't he say, let them hear Christ and the apostles? The answer is, this was before the Christian age. This was during the times of the law of Moses. But if it were during the time of the law of Moses, it was before the Christian dispensation. If it were before the Christian dispensation, it was before the end of time. If it were before the end of time, it was before the judgment, the resurrection of the body, and so on. So this is not a picture of the eternal state. Now let's see what occurs at that time. In John chapter 5, verses 28 and 9, it is said that the hour is coming in which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice and come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. That is, at the last great day, when our Lord shall appear, the graves will be opened. Of course, the living saints will join the righteous saints who have been raised. Together be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Be carried to that eternal city. This is the ultimate destiny of the righteous. Are we conscious beyond the door of death? Of course we are. As a matter of fact, the body is simply the house in which we live. When you move from one house to another, you don't leave your personality, your consciousness, your awareness, your memory behind. Neither when you move out of your body do you leave your memory or your personality or your consciousness. I have engaged in controversy with materialists for the last 40 years, publicly and privately many times. I have never discussed these matters, but what one of those people tries to use, a statement found in Ecclesiastes 9, and to this hour, I've never heard one of them quoted correctly. I've heard them quoted time after time after time across the years. I never heard one of them quoted correctly. Here's the way they cite it. The living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything. Then they look at you and trump and say, don't you see, the dead don't know anything. I've often pointed out that we're out of handle the Word of God in such deceitful fashion. I'd cut them off from all hope because I'd quote a little more of it, but not all of it, like this. The living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything, neither have they any more reward, period. That'd cut them off from all hope. Look at the whole of the statement. Look at it at its modifiers. The living know that they shall die, the dead know not anything, neither have they any more reward. Under the sun. Where is it that the dead know not anything and have no more reward? Under the sun. Why? Because they're no longer under the sun. They've gone from this existence. Tonight I'm aware of what's happening here in this neighborhood and in this vicinity and in this building. 1 week from tonight, the Lord willing, I'll be in Gainesville, Florida. Now I don't know what's happening up here. But that doesn't mean, certainly doesn't mean that I'll be unconscious down in Florida. The dead are gone from this existence, and hence are not aware of what's happening here on earth. That's the meaning of that passage. Shall we know each other there? Of course we shall. Take from us the glad expectation of a reunion on golden shores, and you rob heaven of one of its sweetest delights. I never heard but three arguments against it. The Bible abounds with arguments in support. I wish I had the time tonight to present. Well, let's take a look at some of the objections. One, there are those who have the idea that in the next life we'll be spirit beings, somewhat like a child imagines a fairy dancing on the lawn to be. How can such have recognizable qualities? Well, in the first place, the Bible doesn't teach that we'll be intangible beings. It teaches that we'll be possessed of a body. I make bold to say this very body changed from a mortal to an immortal. Paul, in that great chapter of 1 Corinthians, in which he is discussing in great detail the resurrection of the body, says it is sown in weakness, it is raised in power, it is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory, it is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. Look at those pronouns. The antecedent of them must be the same in each case. Paul said, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trump, for the trumpet of God shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. Now note, this mortal must put on immortality. This corruptible must put on incorruption. For when this mortal shall have put on immortality, and this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? What? This mortal must put on immortality. This corruptible must put on incorruption. That which is mortal is that which is subject to death. That which is corruptible is that which is subject to decay. Hence, Paul affirms death and decay are some part of us. But that's the allusion to the body, since the spirit is immortal. And so when he says, this mortal, what mortal? This mortal must put on immortality. This corruptible, what corruptible? This corruptible must put on incorruption. Secondly, there are those who think that the Sadducean dilemma creates a problem here. You remember that the Sadducees, who rejected the doctrine of spirits and the resurrection, opposed the Savior because he taught the resurrection. They trumped up a case that was designed, if not to make the resurrection impossible, at least to make it ridiculous. They assumed a case where a woman married a man and he died. They had no children. Now, under the law of Moses, there was the Levirate law, where when that situation existed, if a woman was willing, she would marry the deceased brother and raise up children to the first husband. Well, they imagine her marrying a second man. He died without children, and a third, and a fourth, and a fifth, and a sixth, and a seventh. Each one of them marrying each one of them dying in turn. finally she died. Then they rather triumphantly asked, whose will she be in the resurrection? As if there'd be some problem in picking out her proper husband in the resurrection if there were such. But our Lord simply said, you do err not knowing the scriptures and the power of God, for in the resurrection they neither marry nor given in marriage, but are like the angels. That is, in heaven the marital relationships will not exist. The third objection, perhaps the most common of all, is this. You say we'll know each other in heaven? Yes. Be conscious of each other's presence there, sir. Well, if that be true, and some of our loved ones are not there, we'll know it. How then could we be happy in heaven if some of our loved ones are not there and we know it? Let's take a look at the alternative. Let's just suppose, for example, that we won't know each other. What does that type of reasoning lead to? This. That a person can't be happy unless, number one, all of his loved ones are in heaven and he knows every one of them is there. But on the assumption that we won't know each other, then every one of them could be there. But you wouldn't know a single one, in which case you'd be unhappy even though they're there. That'd help the situation. That just compounds the difficulty. Now, I point out to you this. That if there are those who are not there, it'll be because they don't choose to go. And when the mists are cleared away, and we're far, far better able to acquiesce in the righteous judgment of God than we are with our feeble and finite minds here, we'll recognize that He does all things well. Do you still struggle with that matter? Well, consider this. Most people have loved ones who are not members of the church. You wish they were. Now, you couldn't do this if you wanted to. But does it appeal to you to make a proposition like this to them? Now, ordinarily, only those who obey the gospel have a right to our fellowship. But in your case, we're going to make an exception. In spite of the fact and despite the fact that you trample under your feet the commandments of the Lord and positively refuse to obey Him, that's all right. Come right along. Be one of us and enjoy the full fellowship of the congregation. Not one of us would be willing to make that proposition, however dear the person might be to us. Why? Because we recognize that only those who obey the Lord have a right to the fellowship of the Lord's people. Well, if we can see that here, friends, don't you think when the mists are clear that we'll be able far, far better to recognize the justice of Him who does all things well? There is another group of whom I have not spoken and will not speak except for 1 minute, who also will maintain a conscious existence, who also will live forever, but for whom there will be no happiness, no joy, no satisfaction, but the blackness and the darkness of the outside. Two of the coldest words in the Bible, in my view, are in the story of the rich man and Lazarus, and particularly in Abraham's address to the rich man when he said, "Son, remember." Memory is a wonderful thing. It enables us to call up the happy moments of the past and relive the joys that brought delight to our souls. Memory, on the other hand, can be a terrible, torturous thing. It can cause to loom up into our consciousness that which we'd give the world to forget. If there were no fire save the fire of memory, and of course there will be, that would be insufferable enough. It may well be that to someone in this audience, it's easily possible that somebody in this audience will have some prophet, priest, or king, or some other person to say to you, "Son or daughter, remember." Remember the sermons that were preached, the invitations that were extended, the exhortations that were made, the prayers that were prayed, the tears that were shed, all of which you rejected. "Son or daughter, remember." If there is any supreme folly, if there is any course in life that is utterly senseless in nature, it is for a person endowed with an immortal soul to throw it away for a few years, months, or days of this world's affairs. The moment we may not be interested. We may brush these things aside. Anything will be over in the next century before I die. What difference does it make? Whether it's then or a million years from now, die you will. And I have tonight depicted the scenes through which you will pass. And bear in mind that these matters will be significant a billion years after the things of this world are gone and forgotten. Men talk about in detail the end of the world and sometimes try to set dates for it. You realize, friends, that that's a moot question for us, very likely for all of us. Because so far as we're concerned, the end of the world is when we die. That's the end of this world so far as we're concerned. will no longer be here, its affairs will no longer concern us, and the things that have to do with it will be behind us. The important thing is to be ready for the world to come. To do so, you must obey the gospel. Be a Christian, you must believe, repent of your sins, confess your faith in the Lord, be baptized into Him. These are the steps that lead to forgiveness.